Hello, everybody. Hi. We're going to get started. It's 7 o'clock. I'd like to welcome everybody here. And as we start, we're knowing that we're here for one purpose, to worship Jesus, to give thanks, to lift up His name tonight. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I'm thankful so much for this meeting here. Lord, I pray that you bless it with your Holy Spirit. Be here to bless me as I worship, as I lead the congregation. Father, bless this place with your wonderful presence. Bless us with the possibility of knowing you closer, a building relationship with you, Jesus. We love you. We thank you. In your holy name, we pray. Amen.
Oh, yeah. Bound up in shackles of all my faith.
prisoner and say to me, son, stop fighting the fight that's already been won. I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. Oh, I'm redeemed. All my life I've been called unworthy. Named by the voice of my shame and chains, wipe away every stain. I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. Thank you, Jesus, for redeeming us. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood that you pour out.
Thank you, God, while we were still sinners, you poured out your love for us. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence here, for your Holy Spirit in this room. We want to worship you. Nothing else is worth. ourselves you, Lord. We want to enter in.
That God spoke to us over and over again, and it's one that I want to share with you tonight. So the title of the message is Work, and we're going to be looking at the book of Nehemiah to see somebody who was a very great worker, someone who knew what work meant. And so, taking inspiration from Nehemiah, we're going to be seeing four principles in the Word. Now, I start this by saying that there will always be work. There's always going to be things that we're going to need to do, and the closer we walk with God, the more these things become evident. When we're first saved, perhaps it seems more that the important thing is about our relationship with God, getting to understand it. But as we move closer to our relationship, we find that God wants us to work, and He will create opportunities to do that. It doesn't matter what we may be or where, what situation that we might find ourselves, we might be missionaries or not. But until the return of Jesus, there's always going to be work to be done. And of course, the return of Jesus is, the earth is going to end after that, so we're not going to need to work. But we don't know. We don't know if in heaven there's going to be duties for us to do, and it's something that we need to cultivate into ourselves. It's not going to be the same work as we do on earth, but this attitude of working, of wanting to get things done, is something that will follow us for the rest of our life, especially as believers. So to explore these characteristics that make up a good worker, we will take a look at Nehemiah. So we will start this with the first chapter of the book, and we're going to read. In the month of Kislev, of the 20th year, I was in the citadel of Susa. That's roughly around modern Iran. When Hanani, one of my brothers, came with other men from Judah. I asked them about the Jews, the remnant preserved after the captivity, and about Jerusalem. They answered me, "The survivors of the captivity there in the province are in great distress and under reproach. The wall of Jerusalem has been breached, its gates gutted by fire." When I heard this report, I began to weep and continued mourning for several days, fasting and praying before the God of heaven. So we see in this first chapter that there is a work, there is a need, there's something that's going on. Nehemiah hears something about what's happening in Jerusalem, and there is a need for work. And his first response after that is to be ready to start praying. And so we see in this a kind of an attitude. So hearing about the work to be done will affect us in some way. It might lead us to pray. It might affect us emotionally. It might affect us in other ways. It might be a more subtle thing, a pulling, a tugging. It might be some kind of a distress. I felt this in different ways throughout the time that I've been instructed by God to do different things. He's called me out and spoke to me about things. He's given me emotions about certain people, a certain place. And sometimes it's not something that you know straight away, but when you land in that country, suddenly something comes up. When you go into that house, when you step into that zone where the work needs to start, then you feel it there in that place. So it's got a lot to do with location sometimes. But as Nehemiah learns about the state of his country, he's struck emotionally. We see that because he starts to weep. It says, he is moved and he begins to pray. And this is the beginning of the call to work. And now we're going to see four qualities that from this point on, Nehemiah starts taking on. The first quality I called willingness. Work means to be willing. And this willingness means a desire, a passion, a call. It has to come from within you. In other words, I can't inspire this willingness in other people by speaking to them. Be willing to go. That's not going to work. That's never going to happen. It has to come from within you. The moment you hear about a work, it strikes you personally. And with God's work, that's how it happens. It has to do with you personally. He doesn't give that same work to other people. No, it's spoken to you for a perfect reason. Because you are the one that's receptive for that work. You are the one that's ready. You are the one that's been prepared. And that work is for you. So upon hearing about the need for work or workers, we then rise up in action and become willing. We rise up our hands to participate in whatever is needed. So we realize that there's something there, and there's one or two options. You could either rise up and do something about it, or you could be unwilling and then not go and not do anything about it. And just know that there's a need for work, but then you will stay unwilling. And in most cases, God will chase you down. He will find ways to remind you of that thing that you need to do. He will follow you. He will keep reminding you. He will make it something that is almost unbearable for you to forget about. And that's how usually we know that there's work, a call for God, because it's that unbearable thing that just keeps coming up again and again and again. And it will happen like that until you become willing to go or do something about it. You might not know what to do, but that's okay. It doesn't matter. You don't need to know. You just need to be willing. It doesn't matter. You don't need to be equipped. He's not calling perfect people. He just wants you to obey his call. So the first part here is willing, and we're going to see this in the text. I'm going to jump ahead a little bit to Nehemiah chapter 2. So he says, in the month Nisan, okay, this is about 5 to 6 months after. So he starts praying in 1 month, and he hears the story, and he waits this amount of time until something happens. In the month Nisan of the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when the wine was in my charge, which means that he was the cupbearer to the king, he held a position of regard, I took some and offered it to the king. Because I had never before been sad in his presence, the king asked me, "Why do you look sad? If you are not sick, you must be sad at heart." Though I was seized with great fear, I answered the king, "May the king live forever. How could I not look sad when the city where my ancestors are buried lies in ruins and its gates consumed by fire?" The king asked me, "What is it then that you wish?" I prayed to the God of heaven and then answered the king, "If it please the king, and if your servant is deserving of your favor, send me to Judah, to the city where my ancestors are buried, that I may rebuild it." So Nehemiah was willing because in the moments that passed through when he started praying to hear, he had to wait. It might not come straight away. You might hear about the work, but it might take some months for it to come. But when it comes, Nehemiah is ready. So we already see his willingness right here. He asks the king, "Can I go? I need to go." And it's so much so that it affects him emotionally. So we're going to see now in the second part here if we can go to the next slide. Nehemiah's willingness is expressed in words to the king as a desire to go. And it's within his emotions too. It's so much so that it's in his face. When the king sees him, he senses there's something on you. He is so affected by this need to go that it's in his emotions. It's in his face. And sometimes it's with us. It's with Praveena and myself right now, because although we enjoy being in Singapore and we like being here and it's home, it is hard to be here because we know that there is some work to be done elsewhere. We miss our work back in Cambodia. We miss it terribly because it's an addicting thing. And you're going to see this by the end of this preaching. You're going to understand that this work is something that once you grab a hold of it, you can never let it go. It will stay with you. You will want to go back. You'll want to be doing more of what you were doing. He was a willing man, so God gave him an opportunity. God will grant us chances to fulfill these opportunities. This is absolutely true. The moment that you know that there is a need for work and you might wait for that need to become present and alive, the opportunities just start coming your way. Things start opening up. People start coming to you and talking. When Praveena and I heard about Cambodia and we knew that we wanted to go there, we didn't know what to do yet. We had no idea. It was only later that we had an opportunity, several months later, in fact, that we knew that, oh, okay, so there's this place called It's a Wrap and you need somebody to start it up and, you know, we thought you could help. We didn't know that before then. We had no idea. We just went to Cambodia. We just went there and we started our lives there, but we didn't know what we had to do. The few people we were connected with, but nothing like an actual work to be done. So even if we don't know, it's more important that we become willing so that in that willingness, there can be this opportunity given by God. God sees your willingness. He says, great, he's willing. Bam, send him an opportunity. An opportunity will come. And he will test your heart. He's going to make sure that you're willing. He's going to make sure that you're going to respond to this thing. And it's not going to be easy. It might take time. And a lot of things can happen in time. A lot of people can come to you and try to shake you off your way. A lot of other opportunities can come that aren't the right opportunity to try to get you off your feet. But if you know what the work is, then you will know your path. So always keep that in mind. And a willing heart is like that. Nehemiah prayed for several months before the opportunity came up, but he stayed faithful to what he wanted to do. So this part is very, very important. Just to stay faithful to what it means, to what the work is. And now we're going to move to the second point. Work means being organized. Yes, that sounds odd and pedantic, but being organized is incredibly important to work. If you were working in a completely chaotic and cluttered environment, although that might be your personality and that's fine, you have to find a way to be organized to get the work up and going. We didn't just go to Cambodia and steal a tuk-tuk and then put things on it and then scream at people to buy food. No, we were organized. There's things, menus have to be drafted. We long process to get the tuk-tuk painted, all these things. It takes organization. It always does. And you have to find a way to get what you need. Once the willingness has been given, then to make our words match up to our enthusiasm, one must start to get organized. This is something that Paul was talking about in 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians 8, he talks about a congregation of people who are willing to give money, and another congregation in another place that were also willing to give money, but he said, you need to be constant with what you're doing. You are willing, but where's the money? You're willing, but where's the action to back it up? So it's great that you're willing. Now you need to get organized. How are you going to do what you need to do? And even if your work is to bless another person, it is to give an offering to somebody, you need to get organized. You organize your finances. Whatever it might be that you need to get organized. There's always something that will need organization because God works that way. So you need to find out this. What is needed? What do you need to do the work? Do you need permits? Do you need licenses? What do you need to buy? Do you need a house? Do you need lodging? Who do you need to contact? Do you need to learn the language? Go learn the language. All these different things are part of being organized, and it's something that's very, very important. It's important because when not just missionaries, but any kind of workers go out into a place to do work without being prepared, you can destroy the work that's already in place. You can be found hindering what was already there, and you could actually make things more difficult for people that follow you. So instead of being that person, be the one who is organized. Be that one who is prepared. This is a part of counting the cost. Jesus said you need to count the cost. It's important for you to count the cost. Don't just be brazen and do things without thinking. It is important to think. It is important to be wise. Understanding what needs to be prepared. And we see this in Nehemiah's character here in chapter 2, 6 to 8. It says, "Then the king, with the queen seated beside him, asked me, 'How long will your journey take and when will you return?' My answer was acceptable to the king and he agreed to let me go. I set a date for my return." So he had already planned this out. And this is why I love studying Nehemiah, because he's done this many times. If he's a cupbearer, he's already risen to this position. He's already understood a lot of these concepts. He knows what he needs to give the king. In these times he's already thought about it. If I go there, then I can come back there. The king will accept this. This will be good. He's already thought about all this. He's a trained person. He's not just doing this for the first time. I asked the king further, "If it pleases the king," and now see how specific he gets, okay? "Let letters be given to me for the governors of west of Euphrates, that they may give me safe conduct till I arrive in Judah. Also, a letter for Asaph, the keeper of the royal woods, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the temple citadel, for the city wall and the house that I will occupy." Notice that he's not been there yet. He hasn't been, he's heard a report, but he hasn't been there, yet he knows already kind of what's needed. And then he says, "Since I enjoyed the good favor of my God, the king granted my requests." So he's asking for many things. He's asking for letters. Letters are visas. It's the same thing. He's getting visas to go from one place to another. So he's asking the king for all these different things, for visas to get in here. I'm gonna need lumber, wood, whatever, which is pretty much money. He's gonna need money and resources to do what he needs to do. And so he goes out and get it. And that's the amazing thing about Nehemiah. That's why we're learning from him, because he's experienced and he knows what he's talking about. Let's go to the next slide. It says, Nehemiah is a veteran worker. We can see this by the knowledge of what he might need and require. He asks the king for precise things he will need on his journey. He doesn't just say, "Oh, I don't know, give me some money and maybe I'll need some people with me. And oh, I don't know, give me a letter or two for somebody or some, I don't know, just address them randomly." No, he knows who he needs to talk to. He knows who he needs to be in contact with. He is precise about the things he asks for. And Stephen always talks to us about being precise in our prayer to God. And it's important also to be precise with men about what we are and what our needs are. Being prepared is not silly. It's a very wise thing. However, there is a limit to all things, because we can just be stuck in preparation. And there are people that are stuck in preparation. They think, okay, I need to get organized. And then they start organizing. And then a year later, they're still organizing themselves. And they're still finding a way. And they're 2 years down the road, they're still organizing and still preparing, still finding a way. 3 years down the road, they're still organizing, still finding a way. And in the end, the work never gets done. Or, even worse, it passes. And this has happened to many missionaries. We've heard so many stories about people who had something to do, a place to go, and they just didn't. It's not because they were lazy or anything like that. They were willing to go. They were willing to start to get organized, but they just never went. And then the doors shut, and that opportunity never came up again. So it's important to understand, to be prepared to a certain degree, but don't just go to preparation. Just, you need to go to the next stage, the next step. And the next step, God might meet many of your needs straight on, but you must know what those needs are. In other words, it's good to be prepared, and when you do know what your needs are, it is possible that God meets those needs straight away in prayer or through another person without you even knowing. You might say, how am I ever going to get these things? I can never go because I need this, this, and that. And suddenly it's provided for. So don't be afraid of trying to find out what your needs are. Because the moment you know, you have a God that is abundantly rich. We have been witnesses to the amazing blessings that Barbara has on her life. It is something astounding. I have never seen anything like it. Just whatever she needs, it just comes. It's supernatural beyond measure and understanding. And everybody that comes to it, Sarab, knows it. Clients know it. People know it. And everybody who works there, it's impossible to say otherwise. We have luxuries there that you think, how can we get this? How is this possible? How can we pay rent here and there? And when you try to calculate it in your head, you're like, no, this is impossible. We should each be earning $4,000 a head. How is it? It's impossible. But it works out. There's a way for it to be done. And it's because God is behind all the work that you do. So you might think that you're very important, you're the important worker, but you're not really. You're just a vessel, you're the instrument. And then God does all the rest. You just go, you just move, you do what needs to be done, and God does the rest. He blesses you and He gives you what you need. Sometimes He doesn't, because He needs you to understand that you can go without. And He needs to test your faith sometimes to know, what are you going to do if I withhold things from you? Are you still going to bless me? Are you still going to be there? Are you still going to do what you need to do? Can you do what you do without this, this, and that? And, you know, this is a part of God's testing your faith. And He does this to everybody in every work. And those of you in this church know this very well. Because this is a church of work. This is a church where everybody works, finds a way to work. Because that's what Antioch does. It creates work. It's what Barbara does best. And then I joke with Pravina all the time that Barbara's most amazing quality is that she creates work. She'll ask you for a favor. Hey, can you pass me a key to open something? And you're like, okay, I'm just passing a key. And you go, and you meet her, you pass her the key. And before you know it, you're packing bags of things or soaps. And you're distributing stuff. You're cleaning things. And, oh, hey, could you help me get... Yeah, girl. And you don't mind doing it. Because, you know, it's Barbara, you don't mind doing it, it's fine, it's work for the ministry, it's fine, it doesn't really hinder you, but you're always working around her. So unless you can find a way out of there, you're just going to keep working the whole afternoon. It's just some of the wonderful things that she does. And I say this as wonderful, because this kind of work is, I just can't describe it, it's the most amazing kind of thing. It's fulfilling to a degree that I can't describe. It's like knowing that even though you are tired at the end of the day, you're happy. You're just so incredibly happy, you can't wait to do it again. You might complain, especially if you're married, and you can complain to your spouse. It's one of the best things about being married. You can complain to your spouse about, oh, this, that, but in the end you're happy. And when you don't have it, you whine a lot. I found out. I didn't know that, but you whine a lot. So, on the third point, moving on, work means investing in relationships. This is the founding stone of why we do work. If there's anything that should come out of work, it's relationships. Everything comes down to this. Relationships are the foundation of our life in Christ. Fellowship is what we build in church, in the world. We build relationships to get closer to people, to have help in time of need. So even people in the world do this, build relationships. You have friends and people that you need, you love, and that are there for you in a time of need. In the same way, we do this in the church, and we do that to have people to serve. If you don't have people to serve, then you don't have any service. Then you're not serving anybody. Your service is useless because you don't have anybody to serve. So you need to find people to serve. How do you find people to serve? You create relationships. It's very simple. Obviously, operating a restaurant is easy to find people to serve because that's your business. It's what you do. You serve people food. So you always have people to serve. And in that serving of food to people, you talk to them, find out about their life. And one of the most beautiful things about It's a Wrap is that there's a possibility for you to talk to the customers that come. In a traditional restaurant, you can't, as the waiter, go up to somebody's table and just ask them about their life. You like the tuna salad? So how old are you? What do you do for a living? It's a nice hat. Where'd you get it? You can't do those kind of things. You know, it's weird. But in Phnom Penh, in that environment, it's perfectly fine. It's just easy. It's incredibly international. And it's a perfect place for that to work. And everybody opens up. They want to talk about their life. They want to share. They want to know about your life. They want to know about what you're doing. They see it's a wrap. They're interested. Every other house is an NGO in Phnom Penh, so everybody wants to know what everybody's doing. So it's perfect, and relationships are formed in the most magical ways. Just the other day, I met one of the guys that comes regularly at It's a Wrap. His name is Jeff, and we talk a few times at It's a Wrap, but it's nothing big. But I met him in Singapore. He was just walking down, you know, Marina Bay Sands, and I was there, and I saw him, and you know, we saw each other, and it was really powerful just to see him there. And he said, "Oh, meeting you has made my day," and it was true. It made my day too to see him. It's weird how somebody that you can just see once or twice a week suddenly becomes so important. But this is relationships. This is the power of relationships. And recently, my wife and I watched this movie called Schindler's List, and if anybody's ever seen it, you know what I'm talking about. If you haven't seen it, go and watch it. It's incredibly powerful and long. Don't get popcorn. It's not that kind of a movie. It's just about World War II Germany and a man that saves Jews by having them work in a factory of his. And by having them on his list of payroll, he can save them. And it's the power of this relationship that he has with this one Jewish man that sort of takes over his business and does the accounts. And the two of them share this wonderful bond. And it's beautiful to see how him being a German and this little man being a Jew, they just start to relationship with each other. And then he starts to feel for the Jewish people. And this is the kind of thing that relationships can do. It can help us to further contacts. It can help us to become more acquainted with another person's culture. It can help to further the work into other areas. Because maybe you're at that first work for a season and then you're moving on somewhere else. You don't know. God has these plans for you. You might be in a work just to meet that one person. I wonder if my only purpose to be in LaSalle was to meet Praveena. Because, I mean, that was one of the greatest things that happened to me in LaSalle, was to meet Praveena and get married. You don't know what might happen, where you might be in your life, but relationships are always worth investing into. As advocates of love, relationships must be one of our main priorities, starting with Jesus and down to the people He places in our lives. The relationships have to start from Jesus. That's where your first relationship is there. If your relationship with Jesus is okay, your life is okay. If you have days where that relationship isn't working out well, you're not going to have the best day. It's just a fact. There's nothing like it. If I start a day and I don't get into worship right, I don't get into the word right, I don't start communicating right, then my day doesn't go well until I make that relationship right. So we start with Jesus first. And the moment that relationship is good, we go out and then we can start to be blessing to people because we're okay. We're full, we're filled. We don't need anything else. We are capable to show love to other people and to pour out into another person's life. And we see this very much in Nehemiah's life like this. In chapter 2 says, "When I arrived in Jerusalem," so he's already left, "and had been there 3 days, I set out by night with only a few other men and with no other animals but my own mount, for I had not told anyone what my God had inspired me to do for Jerusalem. I rode out at night by the valley gate, passed by the dragon spring, and came to the dung gate, observing how the walls of Jerusalem were breached and its gates consumed by fire. Then I passed over to the fountain gate to the king's pool. Since there was no room here for my mount to pass with me astride, I continued on foot up the wall by night, inspecting the wall all the while, until I once more reached the valley gate, by which I went back in. The magistrates knew nothing of where I had gone or what I was doing, for as yet I had disclosed nothing to the Jews, neither to the priests, nor to the nobles, nor to the magistrates, nor to the others who were there to do the work." Next. "Afterward, I said to them, 'You see the trouble we are in?'" See, he's changed something here. He starts to talk about something that he felt, and now he's making it something that they're all involved in. "You see the trouble we are in? How Jerusalem lies in ruins and its gates have been gutted by fire? Come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem so that we may no longer be a reproach. Then I explained to them how God had shown his gracious favor to me and what the king had said to me. They replied, "Let us begin building." And they undertook the work with vigor. So we see Nehemiah has taken something that he felt personally. He went out to do that initial work where he was going around the wall. And then he started investing in other people. He started to make his one work that was his to be a part of a bigger whole, more people. And this is the other part about relationships, that we're not doing the work alone. Let's go to the next slide that says, Nehemiah was no fool. He knew that he couldn't undertake the work on his own, so he made it a vision. He said, look at where we are. Look at what's happening. We are all in this together. This is where we are, and this is the work that we need to be doing. He invested in the relationships and the people that were around him, and he involved them, and they eventually rose up. Because their response at the end is, let us start building. They unified together. He made that happen through relationship because he built them up. Understanding this principle is monumental if we want to be effective workers. This is the same thing that happened when Barbara first talked about It's a Wrap. It was her idea. And then she's amazing at being able to spread these ideas into visions. And she did that with us. She proposed It's a Wrap as something that we could work in and that we could be a part of. And eventually she built a core group of people that were there together in relationship to further other relationships, to create other people to be blessed to. So this is something that relationships do, and it's something that workers do very, very well. On our last point, we see work means to keep on going. In other words, we've had all the things in place, we've been willing, we've gotten organized, we've built relationships with people, and we're now in the place and we're doing the work that we're doing. We're building relationships with the people we work for, the people we work with. And now, this is the hardest part. It's to keep on going. Never stop working. There's always going to be opportunities to work. When one thing dies, another one begins. It's always like that. You might be redirected. You might be moved. Things might change. But the work never stops. Because love never stops. Love never stops working. It will be a continuous thing for the rest of our lives if we decide to respond to the call of God's work. The workers will always be few. Like what the passage says, the workers are few. Pray to the God of the harvest. The workers are always going to be few. There's never going to be too many workers. You don't find that. Nowhere in the Bible does at one point say, there are too many workers, stop recruiting people, everybody stay at home. No, you need people. You will always need people, no matter what it is. And it might not be something that you think you can contribute to, but it's about what do you have as a gift, because everybody has a gift. Like Paul says, you have a gift. If your gift is to preach, preach. If your gift is to lead worship, lead worship. If your gift is to sweep the floor, sweep the floor. It doesn't matter. It's unimportant. And the idea of work doesn't just come as a career idea. It's about your position in life. If you're a homemaker, that is your work. And it's a work that will follow you for a great part of your life. And that work is also something that you need to keep on going. So if you are a good homemaker, be a good homemaker. It's about finding out what gifts God has put into you that you can make work. Because if God's put gifts in you, it's to make them work. Why? For relationship, for other people. That's the whole point of the gifts in your life. If you don't use those gifts, then you're squandering those gifts. It's like putting $10,000 into, you know, a poor man's hand. He's going to lose them quickly. You need to be able to use the gifts you have and to make them work. Because when your gifts start working, they create more gifts in other people. You can transfer your gift. You can only teach guitar if you know how to play guitar. If I never learned to play guitar, then I could never teach somebody else. You would never go to somebody who doesn't know how to play an instrument and ask them to teach you to play that instrument. They wouldn't know how to do it. You go to somebody who spent the time and effort to learn that thing so that then you can learn. And so that then once you know, you can teach someone else. And it goes on and on and on and on and on. And this is something universally true. Because we learned to cook. I couldn't cook. I'll just be honest. I couldn't cook at all. Before It's a Wrap, I couldn't cook at all. And even now, I'm not the best cook, but I can understand how to cook now. There's things that I can make work now. And equally, if I had to, I could teach someone how to make the recipes that we learned. So now, the gift that has been put into me from Barbara is something that I can now transfer to someone else. Just because I work. So work the things that you've got, work the gifts that you've got, and keep on going. Because you're always going to find new things that you need to keep on working. So we're going to see this in the end. We saw these four things, and now we're going to see what happens as a result of these things, okay? Now, when they heard this, Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab mocked and ridiculed us. "What are you doing?" they asked. "Are you rebelling against the king?" My answer to them was this: "The God of heaven will give us success. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build. But you have no portion, right, or a memorial in Jerusalem." I always feel like at the end of that, he should have gone, you know, like that, or then boo-boo, because it just feels like that little bit at the end. "We will arise and build, but you have no portion, right, or memorial in Jerusalem." So, the kingdom is here in our midst, and we have the power to rise up and build in whatever way we know how. This is what I was talking about. It's according to your gift. Scoffers will come, like Sanballat and Tobias. They will come. They will say, "Nah, you can't do that. Nah, that's impossible. That's going to fail. That's never going to work." And people might come against you. People might steal what you have. People might destroy the work that you put in place. But it doesn't matter. You just keep on going. It can hurt you. Yes, of course. But you don't stop. You just keep on going. Scoffers will come, and naysayers too. But we must remember the work that we have to do. See what I did there? I made it rhyme. I'll just say it again. Scoffers will come, and naysayers too, but we must remember the work that we have to do. There, easy to remember. There's always things that we have to do. We always have to remember what we have to do. And the reason is this, because at the end of it all, it's going to create this very powerful thing. And in Nehemiah, I love this. This is my favorite part. And in the whole chapter, the whole third chapter is incredibly long. Because it lists all the people that are working. And if you read it, it's insanely powerful. It says, "Then Eliashib, the high priest, okay? Usually high priests don't do anything. The high priest arose with his brothers and priests and built the sheep gate. They consecrated it and hung its doors. They consecrated the wall to the Tower of the Hundred and the Tower of Hananel. Next to him, the men of Jericho built." Different men, different city. "And next to them, Zakur, the son of Imri, built." Another person, a different person. "Now the sons of Hassanah built the fish gate. They laid its beams and hung its doors with its bolts and bars. Next to them, Meremoth, the son of Uriah, the son of Hakaz, made repairs. And next to him, Meshulam, the son of Berechiah, the son of Meshezabel, made repairs. And next to him, Zadok, the son of Bana, also made repairs. Moreover, next to him, the Tekoites made repairs." These are all names of different people. And whenever you see ites in there, it's a people group. So you've got people from different cities, people that are different people groups, all working together to rebuild this. The thing that Nehemiah did is this. It's this amazing power. Is that he took all these people, he gave them a vision, he gave them purpose, he gave them work to do. And then together, all of them started to do this work. And when I look at Itzarab, it's exactly the same. Because when we were working there, we had Singaporeans, Filipinos, there were Americans, Mexicans. It was astounding. And the first thing that Pastor Pedro said when he came, and he saw that all of us were working together, he sat at that table and he looked at us and he said, "I feel that God is telling me that this thing that you guys have here, this unity, is something that's gifted to you from God." And when I reflect back on that, it's so true. Because I have now started working here in Singapore and I see this unity, I see factions, I see differences. And don't get me wrong, there are huge factions and differences out in the mission field too. Of course, and in ministry. But once you guys are all together working for one purpose, there's an amazing unity that comes about it. A sense of trust, a sense of belonging, a sense of working together for a cause, for something. Your life now has purpose. And this is the most amazing thing about it. So, in the next part, in the conclusion, this is the result of work. The result of effective work like this is unity. Nehemiah unified all the people to do one work, and it is so an effective work. It's a wrap is a testament to this effect. This is the work of the church as well, through unity. This is what Antioch does as well. We have an international community, and we can all be riled together, and we can all be united together to do a work together. The ideas that we have, they all come together, everybody participates, and together we can form things. And that's how it works here. So in conclusion of all the things we saw, this is what we saw. We saw willingness, that you need to be ready, you need to have it in your heart, it needs to come from you. You need to get organized to get all the things you need. What do you need to get the work done? You need to start building relationships. That's the whole purpose why you started the work. Just like Nehemiah started building relationships with the people. And then you need to keep on going, no matter who comes or who says what. And that will create unity. And so work creates you. We are all here because of product of work. We're all here because Stephen, Barbara gave up their life a long time ago to serve God, to go into Mexico and start work. And even before that, they were already working. And they continued to work, and they continued to work, and they continued to work, and they never stopped, and they will never stop. I know, they'll never stop. So all of us here are a product of somebody's work. Maybe you attended a youth group, maybe you attended a service. Something happened, somebody worked for you to be here. And even before that, Jesus worked for us to be here. He was the first worker of us all. And God worked for us to be here. So as you reflect on that, you see that your life has value because of this principle. Your life has value because you, within yourself, have the capacity to create work and to work for someone, to serve somebody. In that work, you can create other people. You can create other yous. That you is much as a letter as it is, you know, a shortening of Y-O-U, you. Work creates you. And the more you work, the more yous you can create. And I just feel like there's an anointing in the room for work, for us to understand our position in ministry, whatever that may be. We don't all have to be in full time to be working in the kingdom of God. That wasn't God's purpose. It wasn't to create hierarchy. No, kingdom of God is within man. That's what Luke says. It's within every man, every person. All of us have that. And so I just want to pray real quick and just be in agreement with me. Father, we thank you so much for these words. We thank you for the example of Nehemiah that went, did work, even though situations were tough, difficult, hard. We thank you so much for these principles that you're teaching us. Lord, right now, I thank you for your anointing that is in the room, God. May it descend as a spirit upon each and every one of us to know what it is that we have to do. There's always work to be done. There's something that needs to be done and shake us, Lord. Awake us to know what that is. Help us to understand our position. Help us to see our gifts. If we might not know them, bring them to light for us so that we might know what it is that we have to do. There is much to do, Lord. And we know that as closer we get to you, the more this work is going to start burning within us. We're not here just to fill in pew chairs or just to sit down. We're here because there is a purpose in our life. It is my desire right now to see that fulfilled in everybody's life. I thank you for your anointing. I thank you for your spirit. I thank you for your glory here in this room, for this message, for these wonderful people. I pray that you bless them. I pray that you give them your anointing. And I pray that you share with them the work that you have in mind for them to do. I thank you, and I love you, and I praise your name. In Jesus' name, amen.